Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Dragon Kiss by E.D. Baker, narrated by Katherine Kellgren and directed by Rob Grannis.
Chapter 1.
"What do you mean you're going after that girl?"
demanded Audun's grandmother. She set the sack she'd been carrying beside the pile of the family's belongings waiting at the mouth of the cave and turned to look at the 15-year-old dragon.
"You know she's really a human?"
Audun looked at her in surprise. After everything that Millie had done for them, he hadn't expected anyone to object to his plans.
"I thought all of you liked her,"
he said, glancing from his grandmother to the rest of his family.
"We do,"
said his mother, while his father nodded. His grandfather just shrugged and looked apologetic.
"Liking her has nothing to do with this,"
his grandmother, Song of the Glacier, replied.
"You can't have forgotten that she saved our lives," protested Audun.
"We know what she did,"
said his grandmother, "and we appreciate it. But that doesn't change the fact that she isn't a dragon. Just because she has magic doesn't make her one of us." Audun shook his head.
"I don't understand why that's a problem. I mean, I've heard about dragons that can change into humans. What's wrong with a human who can turn into a dragon?"
"I'm not arguing with you about this, Audun,"
said the elderly dragoness. "And I'm not giving you my permission to run after that girl like some lovesick albatross. Now go help your grandfather gather the rest of the sacks. We'll be leaving in a few minutes."
"Then you'll be going without me," Audun declared. "I love Millie, and I don't want to live my life without her."
Audun's mother, Moondancer, gasped and gave her son a horrified look. In the dragon world, the elderly were revered, especially the dragonesses. No one ever talked back to them.
"I can't believe you spoke to your grandmother that way,"
exclaimed Audun's father, Speedwell.
"Please accept his apology, mother. He's young and foolish."
Dragons were honest at heart and found it nearly impossible to lie. Once in a while, however, Audun wished that he could lie, just a little.
"I didn't mean to be disrespectful, grandmother," said Audun, "but I can't apologize when I don't mean it."
He stepped to the ledge that fronted the cave they called home and turned to look at her once more.
"I just wanted to tell you where I was going before I left. I thought you would understand, but I guess I was wrong. Safe travels."
When Song didn't respond with a similar farewell, Audun spread his wings and leaped into the frigid mountain air. He tried not to look back, but he couldn't help himself. Swooping one last time around the mountain-ringed valley, Audun glanced down at the ledge as he worked to gain altitude. Only his parents had remained outside to watch him go.
Seeing the sad curve of their necks, even from a distance, made him wonder, for just a moment, if he was doing the right thing. But then he thought of Millie, and how much she meant to him.
She had left only the day before, yet already it seemed like an eternity. His parents would understand with time. It was Millie he had to go see now. Since the hour he was hatched, the only time Audun had been separated from his family for longer than a few days was when they were trapped in the walls of a witch's ice castle. It was Millie who had set them free. Audun had been fascinated by the lovely green dragon from the moment he first saw her, and had fallen in love when he discovered how sweet and good and brave she was, despite the fact that she was really a human. Dragons often fell in love at first sight. His parents had done it, and so had the parents of some of his friends. It was usually with someone the Dragon King had chosen for them, but it was true love, regardless. However it happened, once dragons fell in love, it was for the rest of their lives. Audun's grandmother often accused him of acting without thinking first. He admitted to himself that he might have been hasty in leaving his family the way he had, but he already knew that Millie was right for him. It was true that she was a human part of the time and a dragon only when her magic changed her, but she was the most beautiful human Audun had ever seen, and she wasn't at all what he'd expected of a creature with only 2 feet. Brought up to believe that humans lied, cheated, stole, and thought only of themselves, he'd been delighted to meet Millie,
who was as honest as a dragon and even more caring. Audun was certain that all he had to do was encourage Millie and his grandmother to spend some time together, and the two of them would get along. Two such wonderful females would have to like each other, wouldn't they? Dragons have an unerring sense of direction, and more acute senses than humans, especially their vision and sense of smell, so it wasn't hard for Audun to locate Millie's trail. Every dragon's scent was unique, but Millie's was more unusual than most. Part smoky musk of a dragon and part flavorful undertones of a human, her scent varied according to whatever form she was in. Because she'd been a dragon when she flew south, Audun smelled more of her dragon than of her human scent. Starting out the day before would have been better for tracking her scent on the air currents between the mountains, but he hadn't wanted to leave without spending some time with his family after their experience in the witch's castle. Audun's long neck wove from side to side as he followed Millie's scent between the mountains and over the pass leading to the foothills beyond. He circled above a large outcropping of rock where he thought he detected the smell she'd given off when she was a human, but the scent was old, and the storm that had scoured the mountains the day after Millie arrived had nearly erased it. A short distance away, he spotted a snow leopard which ran in fear at Audun's approaching shadow. Picking up her dragon odor again, he followed it above the foothills and across the lush forests and rolling grasslands that made up much of the kingdom of Bulrush. The countryside was lovely, although Audun preferred the glittering ice and pristine snow of the icy north. The air was warmer here, too, and uncomfortable for a dragon from a land where the ice never thawed and the snow never melted. When Audun noticed a river flowing beneath him, he didn't think twice about landing at the water's edge. Drawing his wings to his sides, he curved his neck to the river and hunched down to gulp gallon after gallon of cool, fresh water. He closed his eyes in pleasure, dunking his head until he was submerged all the way to his shoulders, and didn't open his eyes until a change in the current told him that something large was close by. A pale face with wide-open, staring eyes engulfed in a cloud of some sort of green weed drifted toward him. Audun jerked his head back, certain it was a drowned human. Although he didn't want to touch it, he thought he should take it out of the water in case someone was looking for it. The current was carrying it past quickly, so he grimaced with distaste and reached out with one clawed foot, pulling it from the river to the soft mud of the shore. Audun jumped back in surprise when the body jumped to its feet and shouted, "What do you think you're doing, you brute?" "Sorry," said Audun. "I thought you were dead." "How dare you!" exclaimed the young woman, flicking the dripping strands of her long green hair over her shoulder. "That has to be the rudest thing anyone has ever said to me." Audun didn't know what to do when the woman hurled a clump of mud at him before bursting into tears. "I know I've been looking a little pasty lately, and I have taken to floating aimlessly, but still..." "I said I was sorry," said Audun. "I don't know very many humans. I've never seen one with green hair before, and the way you were staring at me..." The woman stopped crying to give him a nasty look. "Haven't you insulted me enough already? I'm not a lowly, smelly human. I'm a water nymph, and this is my river." "I didn't realize..." "It's not your fault. I haven't been myself ever since that horrible troll ate two of my favorite fish. What is the world coming to? Trolls stomping across river bottoms, stirring up my nice silt and polluting my lovely clean water with their awful stench as they devour my little darlings. Then humans clutter my riverbank with rafts." Audun didn't hear the rest of the nymph's complaints once she gestured to a raft lying on the shore only a dozen yards upriver. Raising his head to sniff, the dragon smiled as he recognized Millie's human scent. He was sure he would have noticed it sooner if he hadn't been so distracted. The nymph was still talking when he turned away and trotted to the raft. Although the logs were old and battered, the vine holding them together looked fresh. Audun bent down to give the raft a thorough sniff, paying special attention to the side Millie had touched. He also found the scent of the boy, Francis, as well as that of the obnoxious troll. The nymph was right about the troll's stench.
"I've been talking to you," shrilled the nymph who had followed him to the raft.
Right, Audun replied, still not paying attention to her. He was pleased to have found the raft. It was a connection to Millie, something she had touched and used. I've got to go, he said as he spread his wings. Although he'd known he was on the right track, it was good to have the knowledge confirmed. She seemed that much closer now. His search might almost be over. Audun took to the air and recaptured Millie's dragon scent. It took him across the river to a land of scrubby grass and rolling hills that grew taller with each passing mile until they became mountains. These were different from the mountains that he was used to. They weren't as high, and there was snow only on the tops of the very tallest, but even there the air flowing past them seemed warm and gentle. He almost lost the scent at times and had to cast back and forth for it, but when he reached one of the mountains farthest to the south, it became so strong that it seemed to fill his nostrils. Following the curve of the mountainside, Audun began to see signs of humans. A rough path zigzagged down the side of the mountain, following its contours to a village on one side, and a castle perched on a pinnacle of rock on the other. Millie's scent was strongest near the castle, both as a human and as a dragon, so he descended, hoping to see her. He was flying over one of the squat, sturdy towers when a shout went up and arrows began to whiz past him. Dodging the arrows was easy at first, but then the archer's assault intensified and he had to fly higher to get out of range. Millie! He roared, turning this way and that as he struggled to avoid the flood of arrows. Millie! Are you there? A figure seated on a broom shot from the top of the tower, and Audun was certain that it was Millie. But then another figure joined it, and the two of them steered their brooms toward Audun. They were talking to each other as they flew, and he could hear what they were saying even before they reached him. "Hey, Ratinki, will you look at that?" said the younger of the two witches in a voice so loud that Audun thought they could probably hear her back in the castle. "I've never seen a white dragon before, have you?" The old witch shook her head and replied in a raspy voice, "Nope, he's a good looker, though. I wonder what he wants with our Millie." He was calling her name. He must want to talk to her, said the younger witch. Ratinki looked exasperated. You're such a ninny-head, Chlorine. Of course he wants to talk to her. Maybe we can find out why. Using one hand to shade her eyes from the sun, the old witch shouted, You there! And flew higher until she was facing Audun. What do you want with Millie? None of your dragon tricks now. We're powerful witches and can turn you into a flea in the blink of an eye. I just need to see her. Is she here? Maybe she is and maybe she isn't. We're not telling you a thing until you tell us why you want her. Go on, you can tell us. We're friends of the family. I'm not telling you anything, said Audun. It's personal. Chlorine eyed him as she flew up to join them. She met you on her adventure, didn't she? We were dying of curiosity, but she wasn't here long enough to tell us anything. Her parents whisked her away right after she got back. You simpleton, snapped Ratinki. I was going to make him tell us all about it. Now we'll never know what happened. Maybe Millie will tell us the next time we see her, although I don't expect that to be for a good long time. I've never seen Emma and Edric so upset. If she were my daughter, I'd lock her in a tower and throw away the key, said Ratinki. If she were your daughter, said Chlorine, she would have locked herself in the tower and thrown away the key. Audun couldn't wait any longer. Where did they take her? Home, I suppose, said Chlorine. The old witch snorted with disgust. You're going to blab everything, aren't you? So much for keeping secrets from the enemy. I'm not your enemy, said Audun. I love Millie. I would never hurt her. If you could just tell me where she lives. Greater Greensward, of course. Chlorine, shouted Ratinki. Don't tell him that. Who knows what he has in mind? Don't be silly, Ratinki. He said he loves her. I think true love is so romantic. Between humans? But he's a dragon. For all we know, he might want to eat Millie. Chlorine pursed her mouth in disgust.
Now who's being a ninny head? This is a nice young dragon, not some ravening beast. Don't pay her any mind, she said, turning back to Audun. Just head south over the forest and the river. Millie's mother is the Green Witch and a dragon friend. Any dragon can tell you how to find the castle. There are lots of dragons in Greater Greensward. You'll feel right at home there.
I doubt it, but thanks anyway, said Audun.
Chapter 2. When it began to rain, Audun searched until he found a cave where he could spend the night. He finally found one that was big enough, but was disappointed to see that a family of wolves already occupied it. Fortunately, after he went in to look around, the wolves decided to go somewhere else to sleep, and he spent the night undisturbed. Even so, he had trouble falling asleep. All he could think about was Millie. He'd never met anyone like her before. Every time he was ready to drift off, Audun saw Millie's face. He remembered how her eyes had lit up when she smiled at him, and how frightened she had looked when she'd found him frozen in the ice with his own noxious gas swirling around him. He remembered how she'd melted the ice with her dragon fire and had taken the flames into herself when his ice dragon gas exploded. After she had saved his life, fire had nearly consumed her and she'd had to dive into a valley filled with snow to put it out. The snow had melted and she was sinking in the water when he dove in after her. Audun rubbed his forelimbs, remembering what it had been like to carry her. He wished he could touch her again, if only for a moment, and he went to sleep only after he'd promised himself that he'd be with her very soon. The sky was clear the next morning, except for a scattering of clouds in the distance. He had no trouble finding Millie's scent again, but he hadn't flown far before he lost it. This didn't worry him at first. Turning on a wingtip, he retraced his flight path, returning to the spot where he'd last smelled her. He continued on, more carefully this time, and lost the odor at exactly the same place. Audun tried again and again, each time becoming more agitated as well as more determined not to give up. Eventually, he caught the faintest whiff of another familiar scent, one he had smelled for the first time in the castle near his home. It had been the Blue Witch's castle, and although his family had been trapped in the walls, it hadn't been the witch's doing. She had been a prisoner as well. He couldn't remember the old woman's name, but he did know that she and Millie had become friends of sorts. It was possible that she might even know Millie's whereabouts. Following the new scent, Audun flew toward a part of the forest where the trees were older and taller. As he passed over a clearing, he glanced down and saw a nymph with long green hair paddling in a small pond while a unicorn drank from the shallower water. At Audun's approach, the nymph slipped into the depths of the pond. The unicorn snorted, shook its mane, and turned to run. The dragon flew on, and soon the old witch's scent drew Audun to a clearing where nodding bluebells surrounded a small, well-kept cottage with a newly thatched roof and a gently puffing chimney. Three white-haired women sat in the shade of the only tree in the clearing, sipping from cups shaped like half-opened tulips. Not wanting to startle them, Audun landed at the edge of the forest. He was about to call out a greeting when the woman in the muddy-colored gown glanced over her shoulder and said to her friends,
"Don't look now, but there's a dragon sneaking up on us."
The woman in gray lowered her cup.
"If you won't let us look, Madine, you'll have to do the looking for us. Is it anyone we know?"
Madine shook her head. "I've never seen a dragon like this before. He's white."
"Never trust a dragon you don't know, my old mother used to say," said the woman in gray.
"Don't be ridiculous, Oculura," snapped the smallest woman. "I had the same mother as you, and I never heard her say such a thing. She wouldn't have trusted any dragon, living or dead."
"You're older than I am, Dyspepsia. You left home years before I did. I had to listen to a lot of mother's adages before she choked to death on that fried radish."
"Can you two stop arguing long enough for us to deal with this dragon?" asked Madine.
"That's easy enough," said Oculura. "A wall of flame should chase him off. It worked on my last husband when he wouldn't stop coming around."
That's even more ridiculous, said Dyspepsia. This is a dragon we're talking about. They love flames. Why don't we try something like this?
Rising to her feet, the little old witch swept her arm in a grand gesture while muttering under her breath. With a rumble and a whoosh, a torrent of stones rose out of the ground and flung themselves at Audun's head. Befuddled, Audun half turned, lifted his tail, and swatted the stones aside. He hadn't done anything to provoke these humans, yet they were attacking him. All he wanted to do was talk to the Blue Witch about Millie. Maybe they didn't understand.
Excuse me, he called, taking two steps closer to the old women. I just wanted to... Well, that didn't do a bit of good, said Oculura. The beast is still coming to get us. Maybe if I do this...
Speaking under her breath, the witch held her hands in front of her, then thrust them apart as if she were trying to move something heavy. Audun yelped as the ground opened beneath his feet. He spread his wings and was about to fly away when Madin said, "And I'll do this!" Smiling with glee, the old woman fluttered her fingers at his feet and said something Audun couldn't quite hear. Vines erupted from the hole in the ground and wrapped themselves around Audun.
Go ahead and use your fire on those, dragon, she shouted. Those asbestos vines will never burn.
The white dragon roared in surprise, jerking at his trapped feet and flapping his wings. Suddenly, the door to the cottage burst open and a fourth white-haired lady stepped out, blinking at the sunshine.
What's this racket about? She demanded. I thought you were going to let me take a nap.
Taking a deep breath, Audun exhaled onto the vines, which immediately turned a sickly shade of yellow and shriveled. Free again, he rose into the air and cupped his wings so he could stay in place. He would have flown away if he hadn't recognized the woman who had just stepped outside as the witch he had come to see. It was plain that she recognized him at the same time, because her eyes grew wide in surprise.
What are you doing here? She asked. I never thought I'd see you again.
I'm looking for Millie, said Audun. Do you know where I might find her?
Why?
The witch asked, sounding suspicious.
Because I love her, he replied. I don't want to live without her.
The blue witch snorted and said,
You sound like you want to propose.
I do, said Audun. I want her as my mate. I want to spend the rest of my life with her.
Slapping her knee, the blue witch chortled.
Now, if that doesn't beat all, that's got to be the funniest thing I've ever heard.
I wasn't joking, Audun said, giving her the sternest look he could muster.
Then you're in for a big disappointment, said the witch, sounding a lot less cheerful. Her family would never let her marry a dragon. You'd have to be a human before you'd get even a glimmer of a chance.
The crest on the back of Audun's neck wilted.
So you're saying there's no hope for me?
I didn't say that, said the blue witch. Dragons can do lots of things, some that come naturally and some that have to be taught. Your elders figure they'll teach you what you need to know once you're old enough and smart enough to handle it. If you're serious about Millie, go talk to your king and his dragon council. They're the only ones who can help you.
I'll do that if I have to, but I want to talk to Millie first. Do you know where she went? I was following her scent until I lost it over the forest.
You won't be able to find her. Millie's mother used magic to whisk her away to some place where they could talk with no one interrupting them. Even I couldn't follow them if I wanted to. I doubt Millie would want to see you now anyway. She's in a lot of trouble, and having you there would just make it worse. Nope. Your best bet is to see your dragon council. If you're lucky, the members might have a soft spot for true love, if you really love her, that is. You do, don't you? I'll be angry if I helped you like this and you weren't sincere.
The blue witch wouldn't let Audun go until she was convinced that he meant what he'd said. After that, she made her friends apologize to him for attacking him with their magic, and by then they were all declaring how hungry they were and made him stay to eat. While they shared a meal of leftover stew, giving Audun all the meat, the blue witch began to reminisce about life in the icy north, making the white dragon tell her friends about it as well. It wasn't until late afternoon that she finally let him go with a sack of dried fish and the good wishes of four white-haired witches. Audun's wings were heavy as he flew away from the witch's cottage. He had been so looking forward to seeing Millie again that he hadn't allowed himself to consider the fact that she might not be findable. Dipping one wing, he started to turn in the direction of the icy north, but changed his mind. Although he might not be able to see Millie, at least he could see the castle where she'd grown up. Even that much contact with something of hers might ease the ache in his chest. The castle wasn't hard to find once he left the forest where the witches lived. Scanning the horizon, he soon saw green pennants snapping in the wind atop the tall, slender towers of a castle. With the sun at his back, he sped toward the castle and landed in the courtyard. A stable boy was nearly dragged off his feet when the horse he was walking saw Audun. Screaming, the horse fought to get away, but the boy held on and got the animal under control long enough to get it out of sight of the dragon. Audun was wondering if he should leave when an older woman with gray-streaked auburn hair swooped out of the sky on a magic carpet and landed in the courtyard beside him.
"May I help you?" she asked.
"I wanted to see Millie," said Audun. "I'm a friend of hers."
The woman's lips widened in a warm smile.
"I'm her great-aunt, Grisina. Wait a minute and I'll see if she's here."
A flicker of hope lit up Audun's eyes. "Do you mean she's home?"
"A little bird told me she got back a few hours ago,"
Grisina said over her shoulder as she headed for the door.
"She might be resting, though. I'll just go up and..."
The door flew open and Millie came racing out, shrieking,
"Audun!"
Dashing across the cobblestones, she threw her arms around the dragon's neck and clung to him. Audun smiled, curved his neck around her, and said,
"I told you that you couldn't keep me away."
Millie turned her head, and he saw that her lovely green eyes were red from crying, and her cheeks were streaked with tears. Two other women appeared in the doorway, neither of whom was smiling. The older woman had golden hair like Millie's, but it was sprinkled with white. She was beautiful, despite the cross expression she was wearing.
"It's that dragon, the one she was telling us about. He shouldn't be here, not after all the horrid things Millie said."
"I didn't say anything horrid, Grandmother," Millie cried before turning back to Audun. "I just told them how much I care about you," she said, looking into his eyes.
"No human should love a dragon," said her grandmother. "It isn't right."
"That isn't fair, Mother," said the other woman. "Edric loves me whether I'm a human or a dragon, just as I love him no matter what I am. I simply don't understand how Millie could feel so strongly about Audun after such a short time, unless it's her dragon side. Flamesnorter swears she fell in love with Grumblebelly the first time she saw him."
This woman looked remarkably like Millie, and it occurred to Audun that this had to be Millie's mother, who was not only a princess, but also a witch and a dragon friend. Audun squinted his eyes and could see a rosy glow around her, the fabled sign of a true friend to dragons.
"I'm honored to meet you, dragon friend," he said, bowing his head. "I've come to court your daughter."
Millie's grandmother's hand flew to her forehead, and she swayed as if she'd been struck.
"This is worse than I thought," she said in a strained voice. "We can't let this happen. We'll be the laughingstock of all the kingdoms, or worse yet, the object of their hatred. If we let dragons marry into the family, all the neighboring kingdoms will consider us unsuitable to rule. We'll have armies marching on us from every direction."
Millie's mother sighed.
"I wouldn't go that far, Mother. No one has complained about my dragon side. However, Millie, we can't let you marry a dragon just because you're attracted to him. I'm sure you think you love him," she said, holding up her hand when Millie started to speak. "But you hardly know him. You can't truly love someone you don't really know."
"That's not true, Mother. Audun and I have been through so much together. I know him enough to know that I do love him."
At Millie's words, Audun felt a warmth growing inside him like he'd never experienced before. While he'd known that he loved Millie, he hadn't been sure that she felt the same way about him. Now that he was sure of her feelings, he knew that nothing in the world could keep them apart.
"I'm sure you think you love him, darling, but there's only one way to know for certain. Give it time and see if you both still feel the same way."
"Oh, we will,"
Millie said.
"Did I forget to mention that the test works better when you aren't together?"
her mother asked.
Dust began to swirl around Millie's legs, tugging at the hem of her gown.
"No, Mother, don't do this!" Millie exclaimed, looking at her mother in horror. "It's for your own good," her mother's voice said over the rising wind. She was standing only a few yards away, yet she sounded as if she were a long way off. "You'll appreciate what I've done someday!"
"Millie!"
Audun shouted as he felt her being pulled away, and then both she and her mother were gone, leaving Audun with Grasina and Millie's grandmother.
"Don't look at me that way," the older woman told Audun. "It's for the best. You never should have come here. Now go back to wherever it is you're from and leave my granddaughter alone."
Turning abruptly, she strode back to the castle door.
"I'll see you inside, Grasina," she added, then firmly closed the door behind her.
Audun felt as if a giant had swatted him out of the sky into the side of a mountain. He turned toward Millie's great aunt, certain that she was waiting to tell him how his love for her niece was hopeless and that he should leave and never come back. She was wrestling with her magic carpet, however, and was more intent on shaking off the dust that had covered it when the wind had carried Millie away than she was in telling Audun anything.
"Let me help," said Audun.
Grasina stepped aside as the dragon picked up the edge of the carpet with his talons and flapped it until the dust puffed free and drifted across the courtyard.
"Thanks," she said, nodding her approval. "You know, you don't have to listen to everything Millie's grandmother says. My sister, Chartreuse, is a very negative person and can never see the good in anything. My husband is a wonderful man. He was an otter for many years, although I fell in love with him when he was human," she said, half to herself. "Chartreuse still doesn't like him and is always making unnecessary comments about smelly otters and how she expects him to lick his fur. He hasn't done that in years, at least not in public. All I wanted to say was that if you really love each other, you shouldn't let anything stand between you. If you want to be with Millie, I'm sure you'll find a way."
Chapter 3. It took Audun 3 days to reach the part of the icy sea where King's Isle was located. On the final day, he'd flown above frigid, choppy waters where jagged glaciers provided the only places to land. A storm chased him for the last few hours, catching up with him shortly before he reached the island. Fighting against the buffeting wind and freezing rain, he saw little of his goal in the stormy darkness and would have flown past it if a flash of lightning hadn't reflected off the island's icy crags. He didn't notice the dragon sentries who flew out to meet him until their wings actually touched his. Flying wingtip to wingtip, they guided him to the only opening into the home of the Ice Dragon King, leaving Audun at the highest spire. With ice-coated wings and aching muscles, Audun was so tired that he staggered as his claws finally touched the ground. When the door opened and another dragon appeared to escort him to a place where he could rest, Audun could only nod his thanks and stumble after him to an empty chamber where a ledge along the wall served as a bed. Curling up on the ledge, he slept the rest of that day and well into the next, too tired to open his eyes when dragons came to check on him. He dreamed of Millie and of what their lives would be like once they were together. When he finally woke, it was to the sound of the door creaking open and talons clicking across the floor. Raising his head, Audun blinked in surprise at the pair of young dragons who stood by the door watching him. They were both females. One was probably 9 or 10 years old, and the other's age was closer to his own.
"He's awake,"
the younger dragoness whispered to the other. The older dragoness had been staring at Audun in a way that made him want to squirm.
"Welcome to King's Isle,"
she said, giving him a radiant smile. Although Audun had never visited King's Isle before, he knew quite a bit about it. It was the stronghold of the King of the Ice Dragons from the day he was chosen to rule until the day he died. Dragons lived for a very long time, so the selection of a new king happened once every few hundred years. The current king had been selected 19 years before, after the death of the previous ruler, who had been so old that his scales were dull and brittle and his teeth worn down to nubs.
The stronghold was also the home of the king's counselors, as well as of the dragons and dragonesses who made up his court. Because far fewer female dragons than males were born, females were treasured and treated with great care. At the age of 8, dragonesses were brought to the court of the Dragon King to be raised until they were old enough to start a family with their own mates. It was the responsibility of the king to select their mates, as well as to see to the education of the dragonesses. Both Audun's mother and his grandmother had spent their formative years living on the island. Audun was sorry he had ignored most of their stories. It would have helped if he'd learned what the dragons on the island did, especially those like the dragoness eyeing Audun.
"My name is Hildi,"
she announced, letting her eyelids droop in an odd sort of way.
"I'm glad you're awake. Dragons our age rarely visit the island. Have you come to petition the king for a mate? Say you have. All the others who have come are so old, I'd hate to end up with one of them."
Audun shook his head, saying,
"I'm here to ask the king and his counselors for their help. I'm not looking for a mate." "That's too bad," she replied, turning so that her tail rubbed against his leg.
Wetting her lips with her tongue, she looked him up and down, her gaze lingering on the muscles in his legs and the ridge along his back.
"The king is very busy now," she said. "One of the old counselors died, and King Stormclaw has been meeting with her replacement. You probably won't get an appointment for days." "Is there anywhere that I can—" Audun began. The door slammed open, and a burly dragon, over twice Audun's height, ducked his head and squeezed through the doorway. There was a silvery tinge to his scales, and he had a ridge as sharp as dagger blades and the longest talons Audun had ever seen. Audun stepped back from the anger flashing in the huge dragon's eyes. Hildi just looked disgusted.
"What do you think you're doing here?" the dragon growled at her. "I leave my post for 2 minutes to help Iceworthy, and you sneak past."
"We were waiting in line for our turn on the ice chute when we heard that he was here," the younger dragoness announced, pointing at Audun. "Hildi wanted to come and see him up close before any of the other dragonesses could. She thinks if she meets him first, she'll have first claim on him. She shouldn't be here, though, should she, Frosty Breath?"
Hildi turned on her companion and scowled. "Be quiet, Luli. No one asked you." Luli smiled sweetly at Audun and skipped out the door. Frosty Breath growled at Hildi until she started to leave as well.
"You'll have to forgive Luli,"
she said, pausing in front of Audun so she could tilt her head, making her neck look long and slender. "She's just a child and doesn't know what she's talking about."
"Hildi!"
snapped Frosty Breath. The dragoness made an exasperated face and smiled at Audun one last time before she, too, left the room. Frosty Breath squeezed through the doorway again, shaking his head and muttering to himself. The door shut with a click. Audun sighed. He'd been about to ask if there was somewhere he could go to get something to drink, but he hadn't had the chance. Thinking that he would look for a drink himself, he opened the door and was halfway out when a deep growl made the ridge along his spine rise.
"Get back in there, squirt," said Frosty Breath.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.